stinks.
American Toad, your Pac-Man frogs put Beth in the shame. This is what I want. A turtle.
Turtle?
Spotted turtle.
Cat eyes are venomous. Round eyes are non-venomous.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, cool.
You betcha. I have to know this when I was snake.
Yeah, 2 meters can go up to 6 feet. I've seen.
I like those. They're so pretty. Yeah. Brittany's snake is like, what, 100 times bigger than that one? I can hold that one. I can hold any snake. What?
Yeah, those are water snakes, so.
Daddy, I found a toad and a snake.
That's what you want?
What?
I don't know.
Well, as you know, a fennec fox is another endangered species.
Yeah, with the big ears.
Yeah, they got the big ears, which is so, makes it a silly name for a snake since like they have no ears. But,
like,
you know.
If you account in Ontario and West Ottawa.
Yeah. Okay.
And I just stuck her to the side of the tree. There's benches.
Wow.
Because if she climbed up herself, she'd have a whole grip on the whole way. But the water snake can't do that at all. But the fox snake can do it, and the black rat snake, they're really good at it. But
all around, I guess.
They use it's serpentine motion, so back and forth. When you're in a pool and you kick your legs up and down, you don't go up and down, you go forward.
Can they float actually then?
They can swim on the surface, but they are also accomplished divers. So they can hold their breath, an adult female like this, over an hour.
Do you guys want to go do crafts for a minute?
Yep.
No.
They use that to climb. These guys, they've been seen going up brick walls. I mean, I have arms and legs and all those things. I can't climb a brick wall, and they do nothing. And they can do it. Absolutely incredible. She deals.
She'll deal.
She is absolutely phenomenal. It's so funny because water snakes, I mean, you find them in the wild, they're so scary, people.
Okay,
they're
I've had
so
enough.
Defensive. With the biting and the musking and the thrusting. Yeah, that's like a movie that is not a real snake.
No. I'm going to go look at that little one.
I
right?
see it in a book.
Well, it was a wrong book.
Take your whole head off. Look at the nose.
Yeah. I can handle little ones like this, okay? Not big ones like you have, Brittany.
Just because they take little bites?
Little bites I can handle. This one's even prettier than yours, Brittany. Of course, not nearly as big, but... So this is a corn snake, right?
Okay. Right there. I don't care what
you go down my sleeve and I will cry. Okay, where are you going? Okay, hold on here. Where are you going? Where are you going?
Just wrap them around your fingers.
Wrap around your fingers? Okay. Oh, please don't bite because that will really hurt. There. Okay, this one is more my speed.
It gets bigger.
Nah.
It gets longer. No, bigger than that.
Okay, that feels like a worm going through my fingers. Okay, what are you doing? Okay. Please don't bite. No, you're not going out my sleeve.
Which is ridiculous, because as if it ever was. There's Aunt Nat.
Perfect. It was
like, oh, okay. Yeah, she's a snake charmer.
Aren't they gorgeous?
Yeah.
The ferns are actually prehistoric plants. In many of the fossils, you will actually see signs of ferns. So actually, a variety of ferns lived in the era of the dinosaur. You'll find them in petrified wood. You actually just crossed Belgrave Creek, which empties into the Maitland River. At one time, Belgrave Creek was one of the trout streams to come and go fishing, and then it was taken off the list because there was intensive cattle access. So the quality of the water just really plummeted. So with the cooperation of 7 landowners along Belgrave Creek, Maitland Valley, and the Ministry of Natural Resources, they put in a number of practices in which they actually fenced off the cattle from having direct access into Belgrave Creek. They put in some watering facilities for the cattle. They also put in some erosion control measures and reforestation and some native planting along the way. And within a year and a half, Belgrave Creek came back up to being one of a class one trout stream. So we will find lots of fishermen who will now come here to Belgrave Creek.
That's good.
When you looked downstream of Belgrave Creek, we have children who come out here in the springtime, and we do a program called Boots, Bubbles, and Bugs. And the children will put on their boots, and they will go in the creek. And, of course, the highlight is to find crayfish. They will find, we actually have the trout come this far up to spawn. And they also will turn over the rocks, and they will find snail eggs and the larva for a variety of creatures that start their life in the water, and then the remainder of their life is on land, such as the dragonfly, the mayfly, the damselfly. So it's a really exciting spot to come in and explore. This park is open all year round, so you are welcome to come and walk on this property whenever you so wish. And if supervised, you're welcome to explore Belgrave Creek. In case you're wondering what the... So we're going to talk a little bit here about trees, seeing this fall color tour. And most of us have all been taught that evergreens are always green, and they are. And I can remember as a child being taught that they never lose their needles. Well, they never lose all of their needles at one time. This is the white pine. Mm-hmm. And you can remember the eastern white pine. If you take off a little cluster and you separate the needles, the white pine has five needles. And if you spell white, it's W-H-I-T-E. A trick to remember white pine. And white pine, you'll see how they are different. There are needles that are different colors. Mm-hmm. And the needles that will fall off are the needles that are 3 years old. So a pine tree will lose its needles, just not all at one time. So the three-year-olds will drop, and then they just kind of, that's how the succession goes. So they do lose their needles, just not all at one time. We have a white spruce over here as well. It follows the same theory as far as losing its needles, and it's 4 years. And another evergreen tree we have here is the eastern white cedar. And if anybody would like, I'm not sure if any of the children have had, or anybody, you have a chance to feel it, smell it. You can squish the leaves, then go over to the white pine. You can squish the leaves, smell it, and then go over to the spruce tree. Just squish those leaves and smell it. You want to start here?
I love the smell of cedar.
Yeah, I'll be fine.
On your own and want to go for a walk, this spot where the lightning bolt tree is a fabulous place to look for salamanders. Of course, animals will be right now either migrating, they'll be leaving the area, they'll be either hibernating, and the only animal that truly hibernates in our region is the groundhog, or they will be adapting. And speaking of adapting, as we walk along, you'll see you may have noticed it already so far, but we'll see lots more, a shrub, very tall shrub that has black berries on it, very tall. It's a buckthorn, And the buckthorn is the absolute last berry that the bear, that the birds will eat. They will only eat it if there's absolutely nothing left. We all, most people have this envision that any berry out there, something will eat it. But the buckthorn is the last, because actually when they eat it, it actually causes digestive upset. So that's, they're pretty smart. They know to leave it the last. But it is very abundant this year. If you turn over, when you come out here and turn over logs or stones, and you look very carefully, you will find salamanders. And some, the salamanders are about the length of my middle finger, if not a little bit longer. And the salamanders are really unique in that they actually breathe through their skin. So if you have sunscreen or insect repellent on your hand, they actually breathe that in. So we want to look, when you're out here, you can look for them, but don't hang on to them for very long, because that is their skin. And don't try and pick them up by their tail, because if you pick them up by their tail, that's right, they let their tail go, and the tail keeps wiggling, so the bird thinks, I got it, and the salamander continues on.
I don't know.
So it is one of their survival techniques.
I have no idea. Any lizards?
And you know, you can look for salamanders in any woods, under logs. They love to be under rotting logs. Under
your bush.
Leaf matter.
They don't like your bush.
This time of year, they're getting ready to adapt to the cold weather.
See, wrong time of year.
Property is also, there is a wetland area. When we crossed, you probably saw the do not trespass yellow tape, crime scene tape. And we're in the midst of applying for a grant to have this boardwalk repaired and a larger boardwalk constructed for school groups to come, because wetlands, at one time wetlands covered more than half of Ontario, and now we are down to less than a quarter because they've been cleared out and drained. And yet wetlands actually work as a filtering system for our rivers, especially when, and they work as a sponge when we get a considerable amount of rain. They soak it up and then slowly release the water, so they help with flood control. They filter water. Murray Scott, just up the road here, actually had his field done where he actually had a wetland put in it. So when he received a tremendous amount of runoff, it actually has been, follows a grass waterway into the wetland, is then soaked up by the wetland and slowly released, and at the same time it's filtered. So our wetlands are really, really, really important to us. So we really want to make that point to our future landowners and stewardship individuals.
They're probably very acidic then, probably.
Yeah.
So they're,
yeah.
You can see the berries.
What was he doing?
I don't know.
Yeah, starting to get some color on it. There's more water going down there today than there was the last time I was here.
That's where Grampy still
is. This is the main one. Actually, we're just going to go down to the mouth of Belgrade Creek.
Does trout live in the creek typically?
Oh yeah.
But occasionally you have a few trout will be in the lower part of the mouth.
Oh, okay.
Well,
this is too shallow right now.
Oh,
okay. Oh, okay.
Water depth
is good. Oh, okay.
Colder water has more oxygen.
Thank you.
You all right?
I just run it.
Whack.
So maybe we'll just maybe move up just a little bit more and then people don't have to hang out on the bridge.
When I was in the
Belgrave Creek and it's entering into the Maitland River. This year is the lowest we have on the lowest level, water level we have on record. And when we have low water levels, we have a decrease in oxygen. When we have a decrease in oxygen, it thus affects the life in the creek. And when we have, and then the temperature of the water is warmer, which means we have more algae. Mm-hmm. And then the algae then takes up even more oxygen. Actually, when you walk across, well, you can actually see the algae along the edge here. The river is the lowest. If you ever go to Ben Miller, the Falls Reserve, you used to be able to walk along very carefully, gingerly, and, you know, ankle deep, shin deep water. There were, it was about 3 weeks ago, three, 4 weeks ago, you could walk across it. It was dry. The rocks were dry. The water was just flowing through the creek, through the crevices of the rock. So we had low snowfall, and we are seeing the effects of climate change, ultimately with the health of our rivers.
So we all have a part to play with climate change. But nonetheless, Maitland, the Maitland River.
And around dawn, we have in August when we had the owl prowl at night, and we were walking along. Instead of we turned left, if you go right, we walk all along the river. And the kingfishers at about, yeah, I guess maybe it was about dusk. They were just walking and eating. They were very, very ravenous. Very sweet.
I can never count doing it now. Well, I think there's an Irish deer coming when it comes to the river.
That tree's cool.
I have a kitty cat on here.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
It's cool when
the tree is close. Okay, so mine's at home.
There shouldn't be wolves in this forest.
Oh, I'm sure there is.
No.
I'm sure there is.
You're so mean.
My left.
There's
Jim.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I've had a few.
So you just kind of want to move up a little bit, so those who are.
How long to pick? I think it's starting off in kind of heat, right?
Fall is a great time to find, it's the time to find puffballs. So this is a before, this is an after picture. This trail, we've just newly squashed it, so we've got a new trail for the students. Puffball belong to the fungus family, so they're a decomposer. Really, they're not food for other wildlife other than humans, if you can tell the difference between a false puffball and a true puffball. So you really have to know your being able to identify your mushrooms before you eat them, because many of them are poisonous. But they are decomposers, which we need to decompose the leaf litter to then have insects, their habitat, and thus break down the leaf litter into soil for more growth. So there's the before, and as you walk by, there's the after.
There's another one there.
Oops, sorry.
Sorry.
Yeah, I just get to be a... Mushroom. Mushroom.
red needle, red kind of tree.
The white pine, if you look at white pine, they actually look like, especially when the wind comes along, they look kind of wispy. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if you look at red pine, they look like bottle brushes.
Oh.
They're just sharper. Okay, and we'll find a red pine along the way. So someone was just asking the difference between red pine and white pine. So this is a white pine plantation. So this is the tree that we saw at the beginning of the trail with the five needles. Red pine has two needles. And the red, if you were to look at the tree, if you look at this, it's kind of wispy like a cloud. And if you look at the red pine actually looks like a bottle brush. So just, you know, just kind of a generalization as you're going for a walk. And if you ever come across a Scotch pine, it also has two needles. They're a little shorter, and they're twisted. And the story that comes along with the Scotch pine is when some of the folks came over from Scotland, they brought with them some seeds. And, I mean, it was all they could bring with them from home. And they really hung on to them so tightly that once they planted them, the needles started to twist. Just from hanging on so tight. Walking down there because some people didn't join us on that little loop just so that they're all looked after. Thanks.
See, Brittany?
Oops, I'm sorry.
There. Jem's one of my favorite caterpillars.
They are, and we should be able to see lots along the way, or you feel free to pass that one around.
You don't see as many. No.
Yeah, you don't see as many this year.
No, not like you used to.
Oh, I don't know.
Do you want to?
Get those Christmas plans for our summer.
Absolutely, I mean, apples really good.
Thank you.
You're welcome to.
What is it?
That was mint. I don't know.
Could be mint. Yeah. Mint.
This is a plant we do not like. Unless you're.
It doesn't smell pretty.
You just swish it. Smell it and pass it on.
So it's this little one with heart shapes on it.
This is an invasive species. This is garlic mustard.
Oh, really?
And we didn't have any garlic mustard here until we did a bit of logging. Because we have school groups out here, we have to be really careful of the, you know, which trees are dead and which are overhang. And all of a sudden, because the soil was disturbed, it's like, phew. And they will actually, the garlic mustard will actually come in and it grows. This is the first year growth. And then it will stay evergreen under the snow. The second year, it grows about this tall, has little white flowers. From an edible wild standpoint, I will pick this and I will make garlic mustard pesto. So this is edible. But from an ecological standpoint, it is suffocating to our natural ecosystems. So if any of you want to take up edible wild, go for this one.
It really is. It's actually an Asian, it's a culinary herb.
Yep, it'll take over your, and just really, really. That's the white pine.
Were we supposed to pass them on that trail back there? No?
No, they actually would have been inside, and I meant to look inside.
The authority bought this property in 1973 to do conservation education, but also to preserve some habitat in this area and to protect the Belgrave Creek, which you walked across to get up to the
Are you
see it. You can see it. While we're up.
Working on it.